Making convolutional networks shift invariant again, Richard Zhang.
Thank you. These two images are classified correctly. These two are not. The only difference between these is a seemingly innocuous shift. Now, this sensitivity has been analyzed in some great recent work, including in this conference. Inspired by this work, we're aiming to produce a fix. To do so, we must first ask why. Why is this happening? How can shift invariants be lost? After all, we've heard this mantra many times. Convolutions are shift equivariant. That is, the features should be moving with the image. And pooling builds up shift invariants, giving it a little bit of spatial slack. What we'll see is that downsampling, or striding, ends up ignoring the Nyquist sampling theorem and aliasing. Now, striding can be in both convolutions and in pooling, but we'll first start off with an example in pooling. Here's a toy signal, 00110011. Let's max pool it together. The max of 0 and 0 is 0. The max of 1 and 1 is 1, and so on and so forth. And hopefully you're checking my math on this. Now, if we shift the signal by one index, we're going to take the max of 0 and 1, which is 1, the max of 1 and 0, which is 1, and so on and so forth. And we get this output. Now, this answer is very different than this answer. And they were produced simply by shifting the input signal by a single index. What we've done here is we've broken shift equivariance. Let's see if this happens in a more realistic scenario. We can do CIFAR classification using the VGG network, and we can probe each of the internal layers to see how shift equivariant they are. Shift equivariance means that you can do a shifting operation and a feature extraction operation in either order. That is, these two operations should be commutable. Now, if we look at the first conv layer, it is perfectly shift equivariant, as we know, and this is a good sanity check for us. But if we go to the first pooling layer, we see this interesting stippling pattern occur. What this means is that even pixel shifts will give the same representation shifted over, but odd pixel shifts will actually give a different representation. And as we go deeper through the network, each pooling layer actually increases the periodicity of the stippling pattern, making things worse and worse. And this is because this layer is downsampling, but it's not taking into account the Nyquist sampling theorem. And this aliasing is breaking shift equivariance through the network. Now, if you recall from your undergraduate signal processing or image processing course, what you may have been taught is that before downsampling a signal, what you need to do is blur it. You need to blur it as a means of anti-aliasing. In deep learning, historically, what we've seen through careful evaluations is that max pooling actually performs empirically better. What we'd like to do in our work is reconcile classic anti-aliasing with max pooling. To do so, we need to look at max pooling a little bit more closely. And our simple insight is that max pooling can be divided into two operations sequentially. One is taking the max, but doing so in a dense fashion. And the second is subsampling from this intermediate feature map. And this allows us to isolate the problem. We can actually keep the first operation because it's not aliasing at all. What's at fault is the subsampling operation. And we can reduce the aliasing in it by adding a blur filter to the intermediate feature map before doing the subsampling. And these two operations can be evaluated together. So this bottom row here indicates our anti-alias version of max pooling. And instead of just one line of code, we can add just an additional line of code to do so. Now, we're motivated, and we have illustrated this for max pooling, but there are other downsampling methods in deep nets as well, such as strata convolution. Now, it's important to note that strata convolution suffers from the exact same problem of aliasing, and actually the same methodology and the same fix applies it to it as well. So we can take any network off the shelf and better anti-alias it. So we're going to do that here for a large-scale ImageNet classification test. On the y-axis, we're going to plot shift invariance. So this is the probability that two shifts of the same image are classified the same. And on the x-axis, we can plot accuracy. And here's a whole bunch of networks, such as VGG, DenseNet, ResNet family, and MobileNet on these two axes. Now, when anti-aliasing, before I ran this test, my expectation was that we would improve the shift invariance, but perhaps at a cost of accuracy. But I was surprised to see for VGG, we actually saw an improvement in both. And I ran this for all the other networks and saw a similar trend as well. So adding anti-aliasing not only improves the shift invariance, but it also improves the accuracy. Additionally, we've also seen that it improves stability to other perturbations, such as rotations and scaling, as well as improve robustness to corruptions such as noise. So if you're fine-tuning from a pre-trained ImageNet model, for example, ResNet 50, I would ask you to consider going to our website and using our anti-alias version as well. And if you have this snippet of code, Strata equals 2, in your network anywhere, perhaps you can benefit also from adding some anti-aliasing. OK, hope to see you at my poster. Thank you.